A very warm welcome to everyone. This is our new platform Catalyst for the preparation of IIT JEE. Today I am going to start the most exciting and the easiest part of chemistry, which is organic chemistry. I am Deepthi Garg from IIT Madras and this is my first lecture of organic chemistry, which is on IUPAC nomenclature. So let me tell you one thing, it's a very crucial topic and the most exciting as well as important topic in organic chemistry. So without any further delay, these are the topics which I will cover in my whole lecture series, and these topics I will cover in total 3 lectures. In my first lecture, I will tell you about what is hydrocarbon, what's the versatile nature of carbon and the rules for the nomenclature of saturated hydrocarbons. Whereas in my second lecture, I will tell you the rules and regulations for the nomenclature of unsaturated hydrocarbons and hydrocarbon with functional group in it. Alright, in my third lecture, I will solve some questions for you step by step so that you can prepare very well for your board examination and for this IIT exam. Let us start this lecture by asking a very simple question. What is hydrocarbon? From the name itself, it is very clear that it is combination of hydro and carbon. Hydro comes from hydrogen. So, it is clear that it's a combination of hydrogen and carbon, or else you can say the chief components of hydrocarbons are hydrogen and carbon. Now, we all know that what is hydrocarbon. Now we should know that why hydrocarbons play an important role as well as very crucial role in organic chemistry. It's because of its versatile nature of carbon. Now what is versatile nature of carbon? Versatile nature of carbon is because of its two properties. First one is valency, or else you can say because of its unique electronic configuration, and second property of carbon, which plays a very major role in chemistry, it is catenation. What is valency? Valency, it can be defined as a total number of electrons that an atom shares while using bonding or atom uses while bonding. Atomic number of carbon is 6 and electronic configuration of carbon is 1s2, 2s2 and 2p2. This 2 is the principal quantum number and it is the valence shell. Now the electron present in this valence shell is known as valence electron, and carbon uses these 4 valence electron to make bonding. Now because of its unique electronic configuration, as it has 4 electron in its valence orbital, carbon cannot accept 4 electron to complete octet, nor it can donate these 4 electron to complete it octet and to form an ionic bond. Then what does the carbon do? Carbon share all these 4 electron to form a covalent bond with other atoms. Don't worry guys, this bonding, this ionic bond as well as covalent bond will be taught to you in your chemical bonding chapter. Electronic configuration of hydrogen is 1s1, and hydrogen also share this 1 electron with carbon to form covalent bond. Now therefore it is confirmed that because of its 4 electron while forming a covalent bond with hydrogen atom, therefore carbon is tetravalent element and hydrogen is your univalent element. Now how this carbon and hydrogen forms a covalent bond? The 4 orbital of carbon, that is 2s, 2px, 2py, 2pz, they actually blend with each other. Their energy mix up and forms 4 hybrid orbital, that is sp3 hybridized orbital. Don't worry, this again will be taught to you in your chemical bonding chapter. Now, these 4 hybrid orbital of carbon combine with other hybrid orbital of carbon to form a very strong carbon-carbon bond. दिस फॉर्मेशन ऑफ बॉन्ड गिव राइज टू अ वेरी लॉन्ग चेन बिटवीन द एटम्स ऑफ कार्बन एंड दिस प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ कार्बन इज नोन एज योर कैटिनेशन. नाउ व्हाट इज कैटिनेशन? कैटिनेशन इज अ यूनिक प्रॉपर्टी ऑफ सेल्फ लिंकिंग ऑफ कार्बन थ्रू कोवेलेंट बॉन्ड. ओके, नाउ व्हाई डज दिस प्रॉपर्टी ओनली प्रेजेंट इन कार्बन? Why it is not present in all other elements present in your periodic table? It is because of its tetravalency, first of all, which is because of its unique electronic configuration. Because of its tetravalent in nature, carbon can extend its bonding in four different directions. And this, you can see that this is one hybrid orbital of carbon 1 and this is another hybrid orbital of carbon 2. They actually attract each other and form a very strong overlapping, and they connect with each other very strongly to form a carbon-carbon bond. And hence you can say that due to this carbon, strong carbon-carbon bond and tetravalency, carbon exhibit catenation to a maximum extent. Okay, now because of this property of catenation, carbon atoms can form a various type of structure that includes straight chain, branch chain, ring structure, and thus giving rise to a various type of compounds in organic chemistry. And here are some examples showing different type of structure. For example, these two structures are unbranched hydrocarbons, and this is the structure of your branched hydrocarbon, and this is the structure of your cyclic hydrocarbon. Now, next is types of hydrocarbon. First type is your saturated hydrocarbon, whereas second is your unsaturated hydrocarbon. Now, we should all know that what is the difference between saturated or unsaturated hydrocarbon. So, let us begin. What is saturated hydrocarbons? Hydrocarbons in which two atoms of carbon connect with each other to form a single bond. Or else, in a simple language, you can say that when carbon 1 and carbon 2 connected with a single covalent bond, these type of hydrocarbons are known as your saturated hydrocarbons, and a particular term is being used for these saturated hydrocarbon, that is your alkane, with a general formula CnH2n+2. And this is the example of your saturated hydrocarbon, that is your alkane, in which number of carbon is 2 and number of hydrogen is 6, which is equal to 2 multiplied 2 plus 2 is equal to 6. And while naming or else you can say while IUPAC nomenclature, the suffix used for the nomenclature of saturated hydrocarbon is your ane, and alk is actually the number of carbon that present in your parent chain. Don't worry, I will tell all this stuff in the upcoming slides. Okay, now what is unsaturated hydrocarbon? Hydrocarbon in which carbon is connected with either double bond or triple bond. Or else in a simple language, when carbon 1 and carbon 2, they are connected with 2 covalent bond or 3 covalent bond with each other to form a hydrocarbon, that type of hydrocarbons are known as unsaturated hydrocarbons, and those hydrocarbons are known as alkene and alkyne, and their general formula is CnH2n and CnH2n-2. This is the example for your alkene. Okay, now alk means number of carbon, ene is a suffix used for the nomenclature of your unsaturated hydrocarbons with two bonds in it, whereas alkynes means ine is for your suffix term, and alk means number of carbon present in that compound, and this is your example of your alkyne. The very next question that arises is, why do we need this nomenclature? The answer for this question can be explained by taking this example of hydrocarbon with molecular formula C4H10. It can also be written as C4H2 × 4 + 2. This implies that this is an example of saturated hydrocarbon. That means all carbon are connected with single bond, or say single covalent bond. This molecular formula can be drawn in two ways. First one is your unbranched structure and second one is your branched structure. Then with same molecular formula and different structure, then how will you differentiate between these two? Now iPSC comes into picture and helps in naming these molecule and also help you to differentiate between these two molecule. This IUPAC nomenclature has some rules that describe how to name these saturated as well as unsaturated hydrocarbon. In this lecture, you will learn how to name these saturated hydrocarbons. So let us begin with our rule number one, which states that you have to select the longest possible chain, and this chain is known as your parent chain. For example, if the parent chain, or else if the number of carbon in your parent chain is 1, then name of alkane will be your methane. As in my previous slide I told you that the suffix given to the saturated hydrocarbons is ane, hence the name of your alkane will be your methane that has number of carbon is equal to 1. Then if the number of carbon atom in your parent chain will be 2, then the parent name will be eth and the name of alkane will be ethane, and so on. So let us take an example so that you can understand this rule number 1 in a better way. Let us understand this rule number 1 by taking this example, as it is very clear that this is a saturated hydrocarbon, as all carbon in this molecule is connected with other atom via single covalent bond. Hence it will be called as an alkane with ane as for saturated hydrocarbons. And there are two ways in which you can identify your parent chain. First one is this, in which this can be considered as your longest carbon chain, and the number of carbons are 4, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Whereas if you choose in this way, the number of carbon in this longest chain, if you consider that, are 5, 1, 2, 3 and 4, 4 and 5. As according to this rule number 1, you have to choose the longest possible chain, and clearly 4 is less than 5, hence this will be your longest chain and number of carbon is equal to 5, and according to this table 5 means parent will be named as your pent, and as if it is a saturated hydrocarbon then it will be pentane. If you have chosen this parent chain, this carbon should also be connected with hydrogen, but this moiety replaces that hydrogen and connected with this carbon, hence this moiety can be termed as your substituent. And this rule is all about for the nomenclature of substituent attached to the parent chain. Now the step 1 is to identify all the substituent attached to the parent chain. So this is the table in which number of carbon on the substituent is given and corresponding substituent name is given, and that substituent molecular formula is also given. For example, if the number of carbon on that substituent is 1, that substituent name will be your methyl with the molecular formula CH3. Whereas if number of carbon is equal to 2, then the name given will be your ethyl with the molecular formula C2H5. Same, if the number of carbon is equal to 3, then the substituent name will be your propyl with the molecular formula of C3H7. Let us continue our previous example, and this is your parent chain, and the moiety has only 1 carbon. So according to this table the substituent name will be your methyl, and from rule number 1 parent chain is your name is your pentane. Therefore name of this hydrocarbon will be your methyl pentane. Okay, now if someone asks you to draw the structure from IUPAC name, for example your methyl pentane, then you will not understand where this methyl moiety will be attached on that parent chain. But also you can say that you have from 1 carbon to 5th carbon. From methyl pentane, you won't be understand on which carbon you have to attach this methyl moiety. So our next rule on IUPAC nomenclature will be on the to assign the carbon on which that methyl substituent is attached on that parent chain. Okay, so before moving to our next rule, it is very important to know that if the number of carbon in substituent increases, the name of substituent also vary because of their connectivity. For example, in the saturated hydrocarbon, this is your substituent of 2 carbons. Okay, so this has only one connectivity. Either it can be connected with this position or it can be connected via this position, and it has only one possible way to connect with this hydrocarbon, and hence name of the substituent given is your ethyl. Whereas in this, look at this hydrocarbon, the number of carbon in both the substituent is 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, same. Okay, number of carbon on the substituent is equal to 3, but look at the connectivity. These two connectivity is different. In first hydrocarbon, this substituent is connected via first position, but in this hydrocarbon, this propyl substituent is connected with your second position. Hence the name for this both substituent is different. If the propyl is connected via first position, then the name of substituent given will be your n-propyl. But if it is connected via second position, the name of this substituent will be your isopropyl. Okay, now move on to this example in which the number of carbon on all these substituent is equal to 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. 1, 2, 3, 4. And in this also 1, 2, 3, 4. But as you can see that all these substituent are connected in different manner. In this example, this is connected via first position, and the name for this connection of this substituent is known as your n-butyl. Whereas if this butyl substituent is connected via second position, then the name will be your secondary butyl. But if this substituent is arranged in such manner, then the name will be your third butyl. Okay, now from these example, we can clearly see the beauty of this IUPAC nomenclature. Substituent can also have different structure, and they can also be differentiated with the help of this IUPAC nomenclature. So let us move on our third rule, which will help you to assign the number of carbon on the parent chain from that end that will give the substituent the lowest possible number. For example, this is your hydrocarbon and this is your parent chain, okay, and this is your substituent. Okay, so basically there are two ways in which the number on the parent chain can be assigned. Okay, now in this example, the number is assigned from right to left. Okay, and the number given to the substituent is your third. Whereas in your second example, the number on the parent chain is assigned from left to right, and the number on which the substituent is attached is your fourth. And this is your substituent with two number of carbon. So it means from the last rule, it is clear that this is your ethyl substituent, and obviously third is your less than fourth. Hence this is your correct structure, whereas this assigned structure is wrong. Therefore, from last three rules, it is clear that the name of this hydrocarbon will be your third ethyl hexane, as hex means the number of carbon on the parent chain is equal to your 6, and this hydrocarbon is your saturated hydrocarbon, so that the suffix comes into picture is equal to, which is equal to your N, and substituent it is attached on your third. So hence the overall name for this hydrocarbon is 3-ethylhexane. Now next, the most important point you can think is that This substituent can also present more than once in this parent chain, or else you can think of that the different substituent can also present on this parent chain. Then how we will use this IUPAC nomenclature rules to find the name of that type of molecules. Now our next rule is all about that. Rule number 4 states that if the same substituent occur more than once, then you have to assign the location for each point on which that substituent is present, and that location also you have to add in its IUPAC name. For example, when that substituent is occurring twice, then you have to add di prefix. If it is occurring 3 times, then you have to add this tri prefix. And if it is present 4 times on that parent chain, then you have to add tetra, and so on. Let us understand with this example. This substituent is occurring twice. Okay, first of all, according to rule number 1, you have to choose the longest possible chain. Then this is the longest possible chain. And now you have to assign the lowest possible number for that substituent present on a parent chain. And according to this assigned number, substituent are present on this third position or fourth position. But according to this assigned number, substituent are present on fourth position and fifth position. As you knew that according to rule number 2, you have to assign the lowest possible number. 3 and 4 are less than 4 and 5. Hence, this assigned number are correct assigned number, and substituent are present on third and fourth position. Now, next, according to rule, the substituent is having only one carbon. Okay, then this one carbon means then substituent name will be methyl, and methyl is present on third and fourth position, and it is occurring 2 times. Therefore, di prefix will be used, and IUPAC name for this hydrocarbon will be your 3,4 dimethyl heptane. As number of carbon in parent chain is equal to 7, then the base name will be used is heptane. As in, you know that we are studying nomenclature for saturated hydrocarbons, and suffix used for saturated hydrocarbons is in, and hence the full name, or say full IUPAC name for this molecule is your 3,4 dimethyl heptane, not this 4,5 dimethyl heptane. So this is the rule if same substituent are present on this parent chain. Now what about different substituent? Rule number 5 is all about this, and it states that if there are 2 or more different substituents, then you have to enlist all the substituent in the alphabetically order, and according to this rule you have to ignore all the prefix except iso. For example, this molecule, this is the parent chain. As the number of carbons in this parent chain is 7, and this is your longest possible parent chain, and you have to assign the lowest possible number to the substituent. And if you start from here 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, then the number assigned to the substituent will be 4 and 5, which is actually greater than 3 and 4. So this is the correct way of assigning the number to the parent chain. Now you can see that both substituent that is attached on third and fourth positions are different. First one is your methyl, and second one is your ethyl. As number of carbon in this substituent is 2, therefore ethyl, and the number of carbon on this substituent is 1, then it is methyl. Now according to alphabetically order, E comes before M, then ethyl will be arranged first, then methyl. Then the IUPAC name for this one is your 4-ethyl, as ethyl is present on 4th position, and 3-methyl, methyl is present on 3rd position, and hept, because number of carbon on parent chain is 7, and ane, as it is saturated hydrocarbon. The complete IUPAC name is 4-ethyl-3-methylheptane. Now, rule number 6. It states that if the chain is of equal length, means parent chain, if two molecules having the same equal length, then you have to select the parent chain according to the choice given as below. The chain you have to select should have the greatest number of side chains, means substituents. Okay. Second, the chain whose substituent have the lowest possible number. The chain having the least branch site or with the lowest carbon substituents. For example, this molecule. Now, this molecule has three ways of assigning the parent chain. First one is this, second one is this, and third one is this. As you can see that in first and second, number of carbon in parent chain is 7, while in third, number of carbon in parent chain is 6. Now, according to rule number 1, you have to select the longest possible chain. Therefore, you can ignore this way of assigning the longest possible chain, because this is not possible as the number of carbon in parent chain is equal to 6, which is less than 7. Now you have to study these two. Which one is correct, which one is incorrect, you have to select according to this. In first structure, the substituent present is your secondary butyl, as look at this number 1, 2, 3, 4. It means it is butyl and it is connected on 1, 2, second position. And in my previous slides, I told you that if the butyl is connected on third position, then the name given to that substituent is your secondary butyl. Whereas in this molecule, this is your methyl, because number of carbon is 1, and this is your propyl, or else you can see N-propyl, as number of carbon on this substituent is 1, 2 and 3, and it is connected on first position. And according to this rule, you have to select that chain which have least branched side chain. It means that this is more branched than these two. Then this is the correct representation of this molecule, and the correct IUPAC name will be your 3-methyl, because methyl is present on third position, and 4-propyl, because on fourth position propyl substituent is present, and number of carbon on your parent chain is equal to 7, then hept and it is saturated hydrocarbon, means you have to add suffix ene. Now we have completed this nomenclature for your unbranched as well as branched hydrocarbons. Now you have to study how to name hydrocarbons that are present in the cyclic form. And according to this rule number 7, the cyclic hydrocarbon is designated by the prefix cyclo. Okay, in which actually appears directly in the front of base name. Base name means like pentane, ethane, methane. Okay, now let us take this example. Now look at the number of carbon in this cyclic structure. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Means 5 means your pent. This is your saturated hydrocarbon, means ene. Then the base name for this molecule will be your pentane. And according to this rule, you have to add cyclo before your base name. Then it will be your cyclopentane. And this is your substituent. And the number of carbon on this substituent is 1. Hence, the substituent name will be methyl. And this is your correct representation. Now, the IUPAC name will be 1-methyl, as it is connected on first position. 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. And methyl is your substituent. Cyclo, according to this rule, you have to add for the cyclic structures. And pentane means N is equal to 5 and ene is for your saturated hydrocarbons. Now, here come your practice question, as all the rules for your saturated hydrocarbons has been completed. And we will compile all the rules in one practice question. Take this example. According to rule number 1, you have to choose the longest possible carbon chain. So there are 5 different ways in which you can choose your parent chain. In first way and second way, the number of carbons present in your parent chain are 7, whereas in these two assigned structures, the number of carbon present in your parent chain are 5. Now, rule number 1 says that you have to choose the maximum number of carbon in your parent chain, then 7 is greater than 5, then these two structures, or else the assignment on these two structures is correct. Okay, rule number 2 says that you have to identify all the substituents. So these are substituents 1, 2 and 3. Okay, now rule number 3 says that you have to assign the lowest possible number to your substituent. Now you have to check which assigned number on your parent chain is correct. If you assign number to your parent chain from right to left, then the assigned number to your substituent is 3 and 4. Whereas if you assign number to your parent chain from left to right, then the assigned carbon number to the substituent is 4 and 5. Now 3 and 4 is less than 4 and 5. Hence this assignment to your parent chain is correct, and all these structures are incorrect structure. Now next rule says that you have to name all the substituent according to the number of carbon that is present in your substituent. Now the number of carbon present in this substituent is 1, then the name for the substituent will be methyl, whereas the number of carbon present in this substituent are 2, then the name given to this substituent will be ethyl. Now next rule says that if the same substituent occurred more than once in your molecule, then you have to add di, tri or tetra prefix in front of your substituent. Now this methyl is occurring twice. Now you have to add this di prefix in front of methyl. Whereas this ethyl substituent is present only once, then there is no need of adding any prefix. Next rule says that if substituent or else different substituent are present on a single molecule, then you have to assign place on the IUPAC nomenclature in alphabetically manner. And this rule also says that you have to exclude this prefix which is present in the front of your substituent name. Now according to alphabet, E comes before M, and the alphabetically order will be your ethyl, then methyl. Then your IUPAC name is 3-ethyl, as ethyl is present on third position, and 4,4-dimethyl, as both methyl is present on your fourth position, and hept because the number of carbon present on your parent chain are 7, while ane is representing your saturated hydrocarbon. And now I have completed the rules, as well as I have done one practice question step by step for the nomenclature of your saturated hydrocarbon. In my next lecture, I will teach you about the rules behind the nomenclature of your unsaturated hydrocarbons, as well as hydrocarbon that have functional group in it. And if you like this video, please like, share and subscribe. And for more update, please hit this bell icon.